Happy 2018. Everybody had a good break? I don't see any no's, but then nobody ever says, no, I had a really shitty break, right? So my name is Kevin Ahern, and I will be your instructor this term. And this is a little bit of an unusual term for me. So I usually teach the 450 and the 451. So I know exactly what you came in needing to know, because I would have told you last term. Hopefully Dr. McFadden has gotten you all prepared. But if you find that there's things that I'm talking about that don't resonate or something you didn't learn last term, then that's what I'm here for. Come see me, okay? So my office hour policy is that whenever I'm not in a meeting, I'm in office. You are welcome to come anytime. You do not need to schedule an appointment with me. If you want to schedule an appointment with me, you can. But you're welcome to come by my office. Okay? My office is in ALS 2145. Okay? And I look forward to seeing you, getting to know you. This is a big class. Not quite as big as the DB 450, but still a big class. I happen to love teaching big classes. I also mumble a lot. And you'll see I also talk fast. So it's okay to say, hey, Kevin, slow down, right? Because a lot of times people like myself who talk fast don't know they're talking fast or don't know that they're talking too fast, okay? So there's nothing we have to do to race to get through things. I have a lot of energy, and I like to put that energy into my teaching, and sometimes that energy comes across as, well, he's really moving through stuff. I don't go through things fast so we can cover more material. Okay? My job in this class and my aim in this class is to get you to learn as much about biochemistry as you can, because there's a reason you're taking biochemistry. You think it's because it's a requirement. I have to take biochemistry, otherwise I wouldn't be here, right? Probably 90% of you are thinking that. But then you start to say, well, why is this a requirement for me? Well, it's a requirement because it's important for something else. So if you want to go to medical school, you want to go to dental school, you want to be a microbiologist, you want to be a biologist, all of those are going to rely on you having an understanding of the molecular basis of life. And that's what biochemistry is, the molecular basis of life. I want you to remember that. Molecular basis of life. We think about life at a variety of levels. Organismal, tissue, cellular, right? Whether we're talking about a biologist, a microbiologist, cell biologist, or in the case of a biochemist, a molecular biologist. So you're understanding biology at the molecular level. And I'll tell you something. Everything in biology happens because of what happens at the molecular level. You don't have cells without molecules. You don't have tissues without cells. And you don't have organisms without tissues. The very base of that, you've got molecules. So understanding those biomolecules, how they're made, how we control their making, what the impact is of their making, okay? All of those are going to be things that we're going to talk about here. Okay? That's number one. Number two, I sent a message out to the class saying, hey, I don't use Canvas. Okay? I use something better than Canvas. I use the web. Okay? Canvas is very clunky for doing the kinds of things that I like to do. So I don't do Canvas. All right? If you look on the Canvas page, you'll see the link to the schedule page. And the schedule page is shown right here. Right here. And that's where everything's going to go. You see on there, there's all kinds of places for stuff. You'll see that the lecture materials are located over here in the outline. You can download all the figures. Okay? I encourage you to download the figures before you come to class, because then all you have to do is write notes on the figures instead of trying to write the figure. That's just kind of dumb, right? So have things done before you come to the class. You'll save yourself a lot of grief, and you'll absorb a lot more. Now, I also videotape my lectures. You can see the camera back here. And I posted the video, usually within about 24 hours after I've given the lecture, and it'll be linked on there. I also write highlights, and what highlights are my recollection of what the hell did I talk about, okay? So I'm gonna put those together, and I'm gonna post those on there. Now, highlights are what I use to write my exams. I go back and look at the highlights and say, hey, what in the hell did I talk about? And that becomes the material for my exams. Now, I can promise you several things. First, I will not test you on anything that I don't talk about in class. I'm not going to go dig up some obscure fact from my book. Okay? I'm not going to find some esoteric thing that I can go, ha, 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 I got them on this, right? There's no joy in that, unless you're sadistic, and I'm not sadistic, okay? So anything that I will ask you on an exam will be something I will talk about in class, okay? That's a promise to you. Second, I will minimize the number of structures you need to know. If you need to know the structure for an exam, I will tell you. And you're going to see there's very few of those that I will expect you to memorize, because what purpose is there in memorizing a structure if you're not going to use it later? It simply becomes a way for a professor to ask a student a question on an exam. And what purpose is that? That's not a good purpose. The only structures I will ask you to memorize are those that I know will be important for you later. And there's only a handful of those. So structure isn't there. What do I want you to know? I want you to know what I talked about. What I talked about in class is important. And if you can't make it to class, then that's what I have the videos for. If you want to review the material, that's what I have the videos for. Or if English is a second language and, damn, Ahern is really talking fast, that's what the videos are for. Okay? And if all those fail, you're always welcome to come and see me. I find the students tend not to come to see me. I'm not quite sure why that is. I'd like to say it's because I'm a big hairy professor, but I don't have enough hair to qualify for that. Okay. Laughing at jokes is really good. Okay. So anyway, come see me. I'm happy to meet with you. As I said, you don't need to schedule an appointment or any of that. Okay. Comments, questions about that? This is where the class gets very silent. This is where the class will look anywhere but me, because they know that if I look at him, he's going to ask me a question, because he's getting that look in his eye. Okay. I'm not going to do that. As I say that, now everybody is looking at me, which is also good. Okay. There's two ways to get everybody to look at you. That's one way. And the other way is to say, this is going to be really important for the exam. Okay. Everybody all of a sudden, oh, make sure we get that back. Okay. Now pay real close attention right now. All right, let's see, what else do I have to say? The syllabus in the class is required reading, and there's usually at least one question on one of the exams from the syllabus, so I will expect that you will have read the syllabus. The syllabus can be downloaded through here, okay? And it tells you a little bit about how the course is set up, et cetera, okay? The syllabus will also tell you one of the ways to lose points is to ask questions that are answered on the syllabus, so it's also important for you to read the syllabus. You know what's okay to ask and what's not okay to ask, right? I'm not mean. I said I'm not sadistic. Okay? But when you teach a class of 300 or 400 people, then it's appropriate that everybody be on the same page, and everybody sort of know the expectations, and that's why I have those. Okay? Okay. Well, I like to have fun with biochemistry. We're going to have some fun this term. I want you to enjoy the subject. I don't want you to be afraid of the subject. And I know that biochemistry is an intimidating subject. You're in the second term, so you've learned a little bit about it, right? But I want you to get over any aspect of fear of the subject, because anxiety is one of the biggest inhibitors to learning. One of the biggest inhibitors to learning. So I want you to feel comfortable in what I'm talking to you about, and to spend some time and being efficient in the studying that you're doing. Okay, well, let's dive into the subject, since you had no questions. If you had questions, then see, we wouldn't be talking about things, but now you've decided I can have all this time to squeeze more material on the exam. Right? Okay, All right. See, you're laughing. This class has been trained very well already. All right. Well, last time you learned something about sugar metabolism. Dr. McFadden would have talked about glycolysis. He would have talked about how glucose is converted into pyruvate. And he would have talked about how glucose is made, the process of gluconeogenesis, how pyruvate is made back into glucose. Okay? So that becomes a starting point for us. You saw the very beginnings of metabolism last term. And metabolism, I want to define for you as the sum of all the biochemical reactions that occur in a cell. It's the sum of all the biochemical reactions that occur in a cell. That's what metabolism is. Some of those are catabolic, meaning they will break down of bigger molecules to smaller molecules. In some cases, they're anabolic, meaning they are the synthesis of big molecules from small molecules. The important consideration between those two is energy. Catabolic processes, breaking molecules down, tends to release energy, and energy is captured in the form of ATP. Okay? Anabolic processes require energy. They use ATP. They need ATP. Okay? And that's a very simple understanding of the overall big picture. Now, sugar metabolism is central to our body's handling of energy. The reason for that is not the most efficient. The most efficient energy generation in our body is actually in the breakdown of fats and fatty acids. But it turns out that glucose is water-soluble, and it travels in our bloodstream really, really readily. So our liver can release glucose, and it's immediately dumped into the bloodstream, and it immediately goes to where it's needed. If you're trying to escape a grizzly bear, you don't want to have to wait for it to get packaged up and sent to the right place and unpackaged and then start working on it because the grizzly bear has just eaten you, right? So glucose allows for quick energy. So it's important that we understand the metabolism of glucose. We'll later talk about the metabolism of fats and fatty acids, but the reason that sugar is so important is that we have it as a rapid source of energy. Now, as I tell my BE450 class, when I teach that class, glucose is a poison. Glucose is a poison. Your body treats it like it's a poison. I'm not going to go into a lot of that here. If you're curious, come see me. I'll be happy to talk to you about that. But it's important to remember that glucose the body treats like a poison. And when we see things like diabetes and so forth, we recognize that poisonous aspect of glucose. Okay? Well, glycolysis leads us to pyruvate. And pyruvate leads us to several things. And I'll show you those things in just a little bit. But right now, I want to start by just taking this overview of metabolism, and then we'll start getting up close and personal with some of these things. First, we have the term respiration. What is respiration? Well, as you can see up here, respiration is the conversion of nutrients into the efficient into useful energy for the cell. What's useful energy for the cell? Well, it's essentially things that will lead to the synthesis of ATP. Usually what that is, okay? Carbohydrates can be broken down into sugars. It's a catabolic process, big molecule broken down into smaller molecules. Proteins can be broken down into amino acids, also a catabolic process. And fats can be broken down into fatty acids and glycerol, and that's also a catabolic process. If we were to go the other direction, start with sugars to make carbohydrates, start with amino acids to make proteins, or start with fats, fatty acids, and glycerol to make fats, those would be anabolic processes. So understanding respiration is going to be one of the goals of this term. And you're going to see one of the things I really like to do. I like to tie all these things together. Okay? People, especially when they start studying biochemistry, there's a certain amount of memorization you're going to do. Yeah. Okay? But if all you do is memorize and you don't look for those bigger picture things, how these things interconnect, you're really not going to understand biochemistry. So I want you to get that. I'm going to try to help you to understand those interconnected things in the subject of biochemistry. Okay. Well, the citric acid cycle. Everybody's heard of the citric acid cycle. Most people have had something about the citric acid cycle in their basic cell biology classes, or in some cases in general biology classes. And the citric acid cycle is found in almost every cell on Earth. Okay? There are some minor exceptions, but essentially the citric acid cycle is found on every cell on Earth. And the reason that it's there is because it's so important for energy. It's so important for energy, okay? We needed that energy so that we can make ATP, and we use ATP to make other things. We use ATP to move, contract muscles. We use ATP to think. We use ATP to see. We use ATP to have cells talk to each other. All of those things are important, so we've got to have sources of ATP. The citric acid cycle is the most important cycle in the body for making, ultimately, ATP. You'll see it doesn't make any ATP directly. But you'll see that ultimately, the products of the citric acid cycle produce a lot of ATP. Now, that's one very important component of the citric acid cycle. There's another. And the other critical component of the citric acid cycle is its connectedness to other aspects of metabolism. Okay? If you look at this figure, you can see this ring, which is the way we draw the citric acid cycle, because it is a cyclic process. We'll see that individual reactions going on in just a little bit. And I've also shown in here how it is that other molecules can make metabolites relative to the citric acid cycle. And believe me, this is a fairly abbreviated version. There are many more molecules that can contribute intermediates. In addition, so those that are in blue, for example, are molecules that when they're broken down, okay, produce these intermediates. So arginine, these are all shown as amino acids. Arginine, glutamine, glutamate, histidine, proline, all of those can be broken down to produce alpha-ketoglutarate. Well, that's really good. How many people are on a low-carb diet? A low-carb diet means that you have to have other energy sources to fuel the body. Well, if pyruvate is coming from glucose, what are you going to do for the citric acid cycle? Well, your body's really good at using amino acids to make things that make energy. It's one of the ways a low-carb diet works. Hey, you're bypassing all of that poisonous glucose. Not a bad deal, right? There's limits with high-protein diets as well. But one of the advantages is that they are bypassing as much glucose as possible. Okay? The yellow-boxed amino acids are amino acids that can be made from those intermediates. So alpha-ketoglutarate, for example, can readily be made into arginine, glutamine, glutamic acid, and proline. If the body needs to make amino acids and they're not in the diet, it can pull some of these intermediates out of the citric acid cycle and make those things as necessary. Okay? That's pretty cool. We give words to talk about this directionality of intermediates. When I put molecules into the citric acid cycle from another molecule, which are known as anaplerotic reactions, A-N-A-P-L-E-R-O-T-I-C. And yes, I think you should know how to spell. Anaplerotic. On the other hand, the opposite direction, things being taken away to make something else, those are known as cataplerotic, C-A-T-A-P-L-E-R-O-T-I-C, cataplerotic reactions. They're exactly the opposite. One puts things in, Anaphora, one takes things away, cataphora. Okay? So, the citric acid cycle is a very important pathway for anaphoratic and cataphoratic reactions. Okay? I want to emphasize something else on this cycle. This cycle is only the part that's shown in the circle. Pyruvate, which I'll talk about in just a minute, okay? Pyruvate is not a part of the cycle. Only the things that are in the circle are part of the cycle, okay? We'll see that acetyl-CoA is considered a part of the cycle because it joins the cycle, as we'll see in just a few minutes. Okay, questions? Quite a group of people. Question over here, yeah. I'm sorry, say it again. Yes? Things that takes molecules away, those are cataphoratic reactions. That's right. And anaphoratic will be putting things in. So things that make, for example, alpha-ketoglutarate will be anaphoratic reactions. Things that use alpha-ketoglutarate will be cataphoratic reactions. Yes, back there. Are there words for things that can do both? Well, it depends on what's happening. So no, there's not, okay? I guess if I were to give it a word, I would say metabolism. Because metabolism is the sum of everything, okay? Okay, good questions, good questions. And let's spend a minute talking about, I'm not used to this mouse yet. Let's spend a minute talking about pyruvate. Pyruvate, as we will see, is central to some really important things. Pyruvate is one of the most widely used molecules in cells. You saw it was a byproduct of the breakdown of glucose. Okay? Pyruvate can go in different organisms in different directions depending upon whether or not oxygen is present. Okay? So you can see from here, there's three different directions I want to talk about. There's actually a fourth that's very common. There's even a fifth, but I won't talk about those here. Okay? These are relevant because they affect the citric acid cycle directly. Okay? Let's think of the simplest situation. In essentially all organisms, if they have oxygen, the following thing happens. Pyruvate is converted into acetyl-CoA. That was in that last structure, that last schematic I showed you, where I had pyruvate and arrow down to acetyl-CoA, and acetyl-CoA feeding into that citric acid cycle. If essentially all organisms or all aerobic organisms have oxygen, that's the pathway that they are going to use. Okay? Now, oxygen is going to turn out to be critical. You'll notice that there's no, when I show you the reactions, oxygen itself does not appear to join any of these molecules. That's not why oxygen is important. Okay? When we talk about the electron transport system, I'll hopefully convince you later why oxygen is important, but oxygen doesn't participate in any of the reactions here. But oxygen must be present in order for this reaction to occur. And this reaction is critical. Because if you don't have acetyl-CoA, the citric acid cycle will not work. Gotta have it. Critical molecule. Okay? That means that there's no oxygen, no acetyl-CoA, no acetyl-CoA, no citric acid cycle, no citric acid cycle, no energy. What's going to happen to someone who breathes an atmosphere of pure nitrogen? They're going to die. That's what suffocation is all about. Okay? There's a variety of reasons why that happens, but this is the primary reason why that's important. If you can't make acetyl-CoA, you can't do the citric acid cycle, and the vast, giant energy stores for cells is therefore gone. Okay? Now, it's not absolute, and that relates to the other two things that I'll show you on here. Dr. McFadden talk about fermentation last term? Okay. How many people are pro-fermentation? Where's all the beer drinkers? Okay. I'm pro-fermentation. And you don't have to be a beer drinker to be pro-fermentation, because your body does fermentation when it runs out of oxygen. Oh my God, am I going to die? Well, how many of you like to go out running? How many of you, the first time you went out running, you thought, I am going to die? Right? Why did you think you were going to die? Well, your muscles are starving for oxygen, because your muscles can use oxygen faster than your blood can deliver it. Your muscles can use oxygen faster than your blood can deliver it. That means that when you're really exercising, your muscles are kind of sucking oxygen. Okay? Well, if we didn't have a backup source of energy for those molecules, you would die right there. Okay? Well, fortunately, you do have a backup source, and that backup source is shown in the reaction, I'm sorry, going upwards right here, from pyruvate up to lactate. Now, I hope Dr. McFadden emphasized to you the importance of NAD in glycolysis. NAD is an electron carrier. And electron carriers are necessary for oxidative reactions. They're necessary for oxidative reactions. And there's only one oxidative reaction in glycolysis, but if you stop that reaction, you stop glycolysis. Not a good career move. Okay? Not a good career move. So you want to have NAD available, but the problem is when you run out of oxygen, you start running out of NAD. That's why oxygen is so important, because NAD is necessary to make acetyl-CoA, as we're going to see. You run out of NAD, that's why you can't make acetyl-CoA. So the cell does what it can to make additional NAD. And how does it do that? It does that through fermentation. It converts pyruvate into lactic acid or lactate. Same thing. For our purposes. Okay? Now, that produces as a byproduct NAD. That NAD can be used to keep other cellular processes going. Now, it's not real efficient. You don't run on that for a long time. You get to that point where I've just got to stop, right? I've just got to stop. Well, you got to stop because you've really run the maximum ability of your cells to produce that NAD, okay? Did you talk about the Cori cycle last term? Okay, Cori cycle is related to this, okay? So fermentation is a source of NAD, and pyruvate is central to that process. Now, this process above occurs in higher organisms, particularly in animals. The product of fermentation in animals is lactate. Not all organisms go that pathway. Okay? Other organisms go the bottom pathway, and the most common organisms doing this are bacteria and yeast. Okay? You might ask, well, how about plants? Well, plants don't go out and exercise. Plants don't grow in environments where there's not oxygen. And plants can also produce their own oxygen. So plants don't really have much of a need for fermentation. Okay? The bacteria and yeast do. Okay? The way you make beer and wine is by putting them in a mixture, letting them start metabolizing the sugars and so forth, capping it off so that they don't have that external supply of oxygen. That's how you make beer and yeast. Beer and wine. Okay, you don't make yeast. You make beer and wine. I guess you do make yeast too when they start growing. Right? And because they run out of oxygen, they start doing the pathway going down below, in which they convert pyruvate into a two-carbon molecule called acetaldehyde, and they convert acetaldehyde into the molecule of ethanol, and it's that last step from acetaldehyde to ethanol, all right, that produces NAD. Okay? That enzyme that catalyzes that is known as alcohol dehydrogenase, and you have that enzyme within you. Your liver has alcohol dehydrogenase. So why do you need to drink beer? Why do you need to drink wine? Why do you need to drink whiskey? If you can make your own, isn't that the best way to go? Why do you suppose, and you can't, by the way, why do you suppose your body has that enzyme? That's right. The enzyme is important for the reverse reaction, which is important for the detoxification of ethanol. Our body uses it to make acetaldehyde, which is then converted into other things, and it's that acetaldehyde that's known as Mr. Hangover. Okay? Mr. Hangover, or Mrs. Hangover, as the case, Ms. Hangover, as the case may be. Okay, so we see a difference then depending upon what organism we're talking about and whether oxygen is abundant or not. Well, let's look at the enzyme that's central to all of this. It's known as pyruvate dehydrogenase. Pyruvate dehydrogenase is important both for the formation of acetyl-CoA in all organisms. It's also important for the production of acetaldehyde in bacteria and yeast. It's not used for making lactate. Lactate is made by an enzyme called lactate dehydrogenase. Notice I haven't said memorize any structures yet. Right? Okay. Well, the pyruvate dehydrogenase enzyme is a very intricate enzyme. I think that's the safest way to put it. It has three subunits, as I'll show you in a minute, that each have a specialized function. Okay? Before I talk about that, I want to show you a schematic that covers both the formation of acetyl-CoA and also the formation of ethanol and how it relates to pyruvate dehydrogenase. We got some pyruvate sitting around as a product of glycolysis, whether it's a human, a bacterium, or a yeast. Okay? That pyruvate, okay, if we have oxygen in animals, it's going to go and make acetyl-CoA. If we have oxygen in bacteria and yeast, it's also going to go and make acetyl-CoA. But you can see they go by slightly different paths. Okay? Slightly different paths. The path in bacteria and yeast goes through acetaldehyde, whereas that path in animals does not go through acetaldehyde. And it turns out that's a fairly minor consideration in terms of our understanding of the process, but it's a big consideration when you're talking about being someone who brews, right? Because that acetaldehyde, in the absence of oxygen, can be converted upwards into ethanol. That's what takes alcohol dehydrogenase. So, repeating that, pyruvate dehydrogenase is responsible for everything down here. Everything down here. By the way, sometimes people tell me that they can't see the cursor on YouTube, okay? You can, but you have to configure your YouTube settings properly, okay? Two things you have to do. People usually do one. Two things. One is you have to enlarge the video to the size of your screen. The second is you have to choose the higher resolution. I put these at HD, okay? They're at 1080p, and if you select the 1080p and you make it full screen, you will see the pointer. But if you only do one of those, you will not see the pointer. Okay? All right. Now, so the lower half of that is all pyruvate dehydrogenase. The only part that's not is going upwards from acetaldehyde to ethanol, and that's alcohol dehydrogenase. Okay. So it's a multi-subunit enzyme, and each subunit has a function. By the way, there's the alcohol dehydrogenase reaction, just to remind you. Acetaldehyde going to ethanol, and of course, it's going in the ethanol direction. That's actually backwards. You just saw that. That should be NAD on the right side, NADH on the left side. I will fix that. Okay. Go on. No, that's right. Yeah, it is backwards. It is backwards. Okay. I'll fix that. Okay. Let's look at the individual reactions then that go to produce this. Today I'm going to show you some mechanisms. And I'll be very honest with you, I hate mechanisms. Probably as much as some of you hate mechanisms. Okay? So I'm going to keep mechanisms to a minimum, as much as I can. There are places where they're relevant. This is about as, well, there's one that I'll show you later that's a little bit more involved, but mechanisms, I don't get too involved. Okay, so we can look here. You notice I'm not showing you any structures, showing you names of molecules, and we're going from pyruvate to something called TPP acetaldehyde. This is occurring in all organisms. What's TPP? TPP turns out to be a coenzyme. Coenzymes, I hope you learned last term, are small molecules that help enzymes to perform their functions. Small molecules that help enzymes to perform their functions. Pyruvate dehydrogenase uses 5 different coenzymes. Okay, it's kind of complicated. One of them is a molecule called TPP, or the full name is thiamine pyrophosphate. This is why you have to have the vitamin thiamine in your body. Thiamine pyrophosphate. By the way, anytime I use an abbreviation, you are welcome to use the same abbreviation. You do not have to know the full name if I use the abbreviation. Okay? So you can call this TPP and you'd be perfectly fine. Okay. So that first step of the process, there are two things that are happening. It's catalyzed on the subunit known as E1. The first thing that happens is a decarboxylation. That's the loss of a carboxyl group. That produces acetaldehyde. And the second thing is that the acetaldehyde is attached to this molecule of TPP. TPP we can think of as a carrier. It's a carrier. It can either carry it to the next step in the process, which is going down below, or if you're a bacterium or yeast in low oxygen concentrations, it can let go of that acetaldehyde and release it. So only in bacteria and yeast can that process shown to the right actually occur. Now, if we have oxygen, everybody's going to go down. So assuming we have oxygen, we transfer the acetaldehyde to a molecule known as lipoamide. Starting molecule is lipoic acid, and I'll show you the structure of that in a minute. The only difference between lipoamide and lipoic acid is if you attach lipoamide to a protein, I'm sorry, you attach lipoic acid to a protein, you make lipoamide. That's all there is to it. Okay? All right. So the second step of the process, which is catalyzed on the subunit known as E2, and by the way, if you look in various books, including my book, you can see monster mouthful names for E1, E2, and E3, and I kind of like E1, E2, and E3. Simple as good. Okay? All right. So at this point, you have an acetyl lipoamide. Notice it's no longer acetaldehyde, and the reason it's not is that this molecule has transferred its electrons to a disulfide bond on a lipoamide. Loss of electrons means oxidation. Something loses electrons, it becomes oxidized. And something that gains electrons becomes reduced. So lipoamide gets reduced because it gains electrons. Acetaldehyde gets oxidized because it loses electrons. And when it loses electrons, it becomes an acetyl group. So at this point, we call it acetyl lipoamide. The next step in the process, okay, involves a couple of things. One is the acetyl group is transferred to coenzyme A to make acetyl CoA. Okay. The other thing is, remember I said that we reduced the lipoamide. Lipoamide has gained electrons. If we want to get back to the starting process, we have to take those electrons away from lipoamide. We have to oxidize lipoamide. And that involves transfer of electrons to FAD to make FADH2. And then those electrons in FADH2 are transferred to NAD to make NADH. Now I'm going to summarize what we've done here. We started with pyruvate. We decarboxylated it and transferred it to TPP. We oxidized it and transferred it to lipoamide. We transferred the acetyl group to coenzyme A. And we transferred electrons through a couple of things, ultimately to make NADH. So we started with pyruvate. We ended up with carbon dioxide, acetyl-CoA, and NADH. Why do we need oxygen for this process? Because we need oxygen for NAD. If we don't have NAD, this ain't going to occur. Questions about that? Clear as mud? Yeah. Sure, what did you end up with? So you started with pyruvate. You ended up with carbon dioxide. You ended up with acetyl-CoA. And you ended up with NADH. This all assumes we had oxygen present. Okay. All right, so we now know how that happens in pyruvate dehydrogenase. And there's all the molecules if you want to see the molecules, but I'm not going to expect you to memorize structures, okay? Which means that 90% of you are not going to look at that again. Okay, I promised I would show you lipoic acid, or in this case, lipoamide. This is basically lipoic acid, and if it's attached to a protein, as it is to E2, then we call it lipoamide, right? There's the oxidized form, has a disulfide bond. The reduced form has sulfhydryl bonds. And the attachment point for the acetyl group is on one of these sulfurs. So when we regenerate the oxidized form, these electrons have to be transferred to something. They get transferred to FAD. And that causes the oxidized form to be regenerated. All right, now, the last thing I want to talk about here, and then I'll do something else, is the regulation of this process. Dr. McFadden may have mentioned a little bit about the regulation of pyruvate, about pyruvate kinase. He probably didn't talk about pyruvate dehydrogenase, which is what's here. So don't confuse pyruvate kinase, which is a glycolysis enzyme, with pyruvate dehydrogenase, which is the enzyme I've been talking about here. They're different enzymes. Well, it turns out that pyruvate dehydrogenase is regulated in a sort of complicated way. It's regulated both by covalent modification, in this case, addition or removal of phosphates. And by the way, the enzyme pyruvate dehydrogenase is this thing in the middle. If pyruvate dehydrogenase has phosphates on it, it is inactive. If you take those phosphates off, it becomes active. The regulation of that enzyme then depends upon whether we're putting phosphates on or taking phosphates off. How do you put phosphates on? You put phosphates on with pyruvate dehydrogenase kinase. Kinases are enzymes that put phosphates on things. You take phosphates off with an enzyme known as pyruvate dehydrogenase phosphatase. Phosphatases remove phosphates. Now, it's confusing to students because the name pyruvate dehydrogenase occurs in all three of these. And that's why you have to remember that a kinase puts phosphates on, a phosphatase takes phosphates off, and what you're left with is pyruvate dehydrogenase. Okay, so the regulation of those enzymes, the kinase and the phosphatase, then become important to understand whether putting phosphates on is being favored or taking phosphates off is being favored. It's not quite as complicated as it looks. If we look at green arrows, these favor activation. And if we look at red arrows, they inhibit activation. Okay? Now, the other factor that contributes to this is actually this guy right here, NADH. You see the red arrow going up there and pointing at pyruvate dehydrogenase. NADH inhibits pyruvate dehydrogenase. That sort of makes sense because you know pyruvate dehydrogenase needs NAD, and if you have very little NAD, you've got a lot of NADH, the enzyme isn't going to work. A more important regulation, though, is the phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. What causes phosphates to be put on? Well, look at this. NADH and acetyl-CoA both favor the activation of the kinase, and the activation of the kinase favors putting phosphates on. Now, I can memorize this, or I can use my head. When are you going to have a lot of NADH? A lot of NADH either means I don't have oxygen or I don't need energy. As we'll see about when we talk about the electron transport system. What if I have a lot of acetyl-CoA? That's the best indicator I don't need any more energy because the citric acid cycle isn't running. When's the citric acid cycle not running? Oh, probably right now, and a lot of you sitting on your butt. Right? You don't need energy because you're not out burning it out. You got plenty of acetyl-CoA. Your pyruvate dehydrogenase is phosphorylated. Okay? Well, what causes this kinase to be inhibited? Pyruvate, NAD, and coenzyme A. A lot of pyruvate means, hey, we've got to do something with this. Let's send it to the citric acid cycle. A lot of NAD says, hey, we're waiting for this energy, guys. Let's burn it up. And that's what the NAD is for. Coenzyme A, meaning I have low concentrations of acetyl-CoA if I have lots of CoA, because there's nothing attached to it. So these make sense. I want you to learn to look at metabolism by things that make sense, and I will always try to help you to make sense of that, because the more you make sense of things, the less you have to memorize. Okay? All right. Pyruvate dehydrogenase phosphatase is not very big in the regulation picture. It's regulated largely by magnesium and calcium. Okay, and you see those are both activation enzymes. Okay, I've jabbered almost enough. As some of you know, I always like to include a song in what I've done, and so I've got a song to summarize a little bit of the theme of today. So bear with me. First day, I usually have a little trouble getting this set up. An enzyme, this is a song I wrote called Online Movie. Let's hit it. Don't do this to me. All right, we're going to have to sing it ourselves. Here we go. Let's try it again. There we go. And if you sing loud, more likely we'll have extra credit on the first exam. Oh no, I missed my class. Someone ought to kick my ass. Perhaps there is some hope for me. Today or make an online movie. Na, 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 na. Online movie. Dr. Kevin's always glowing. Telling me I should be knowing. I can't hear you. All that biochemistry. Hope there is an online movie. Na, 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 na. Online movie. Got sweat on my brow. I'm starting to weep. I fired up my laptop. I'm white as a sheet. This Firefox is downloading, I'm feeling neat. Cause I just found the online movie. Na 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 na. Online movie. Okay, see you guys on Wednesday.
Hi.